Welcome back everyone, and in this video we're going to start to talk about text analysis. And yeah, I think text analysis is not only in general an important topic, it's also very important in the financial or in the economic area, because here we often have information that is given in textual form. So for instance, we have such things as transcripts of earning calls, we have annually or quarterly statements by companies, which includes a lot of text form. We have news regarding companies every day. We have Twitter tweets or other social media content that refers to the development of certain companies and so on and so on. And so far in this course and also in other courses, all our methods that we're using, they rely on numerical input, right? They need to a certain degree, need numbers, because we're doing mathematical operations here in order to do something, to fulfill the tasks that are given, usually in predictive form or regarding the unsupervised learning form. But beyond that, everything we need, or the computer needs and the methods need, is numerical information. And the problem, so to say, when we are facing textual information is, first, how can we transform the textual information such that the informative content of the textual information is, remains, but is transformed to a numerical version of it, which then can be given to the methods that we're typically using when we want to analyze certain things. And there are many things that can be done, and more or less we are here somewhere in the area of natural language processing, text mining, text analysis. So there are a few definitions, and somewhere in those areas we will now wander around and walk around a little bit, and take a look at some different ways how we can extract numerical information out of textual data. Okay. And sometimes we can use methods that do not rely on the semantic meaning. So, and sometimes we will use methods which rely on semantic meaning. So, sometimes it's more like a counting of words. Sometimes it's really trying to figure out what words actually mean. And there are many, many methods nowadays that can be helpful to conduct this kind of informative extraction and transformation into the numerical form of the information. And we'll do a little bit of all, not everything of obviously what exists here in those fields, in order to give you an idea what different approaches look like and how this can be done. Okay. Before we are discussing any specific methods, let's go through some general things that need to be taken into account first when we start analyzing text. Okay, so what we typically will have is something like a list of documents. Okay, a document can be more or less anything. It can be a single sentence, it can be a Twitter tweet, or it can be a report by a company, for instance. And each of the documents, it consists of a sequence of what we will call a token. Okay, so basically a token is a word, but we say token if we do not differentiate here if the same word may occur multiple times in a document. So for instance, like walk or the or something, those are words which may reoccur more than once in a document, and the document is then here a list of tokens. Okay, and a token is an indivisible sequence of characters. Okay, and yeah, typically a single word. What usually will be done, there will be a certain process of text pre-processing. So for instance, we will remove numbers, we will remove punctuation. So sentences like the one you can see here, that needs to be cleaned in order that our textual methods can be applied to it. Okay, and there are different ways how to pre-process text. Some libraries, they come along with their own standard text pre-processing procedures, and in most of the cases they are really helpful and they can be used. And sometimes if you're facing still some pre-processing type problems after using those standard formulas, You need to dig deeper and use, for instance, something which is called, or learn about something which is called regular expressions, which can be further helpful in order to clean the text, okay? But first and foremost, we have a sequence like this here, and by this definition here, so the token is an indivisible sequence. 14 could also be considered to be a token, but we will only want to use words here. So that is why we first exclude numbers and punctuation. Then also the capitalization usually is not considered. Usually we'll reduce all the text to lower capitals. But sometimes obviously that can be tricky. For instance, if we have something like Apple, so which we can refer to the company, but also is something that we can eat. And so sometimes in those special cases, it may be helpful to distinguish between the apple with a big A, with a big capital letter in the beginning, and an apple with a small A in the beginning, okay? And yeah, so typically what we do is we take a look at the capitalization. Usually we use only lowercase letters, remove the punctuation, and sometimes we do further things. So such things as the removal of so-called stop words. Stop words is something that are words which occur many times in every document. So if those words occur everywhere, then they are not really informative when we want to distinguish between the documents with respect to certain topics or some tasks, okay? So that is sometimes, and also depending on the method we're using, the removal of stop words is also which belongs to the text preprocessing, so that a thing that we do before we apply any method to really do text analysis. And then there are also things which we need to learn about, especially as, for instance, like myself, if we are not from originally from the field of natural language processing. So such things as stemming. Stemming is something that brings words back to the like something like a root, okay? And then there are certain special ways of stemming and so on, but this is something you may want to take a look at a later stage. I just listed it up here that you know or heard, or that you at least heard about this, okay? Then this is like the stop word information, and stemming is, for instance, what you can see here. So eating, eats, or ate is something which all belongs to the same root. So this is eat. So sometimes it makes sense, if a sentence is saying something like has been eating, or the person eats every day, then all those eating, eats, they are replaced by a single word eat, because having a lower amount of non-distinguishable words in a text makes it always a little bit easier for certain methods here. Okay, then, so first of all, we have our collection of documents, and each document consists of those tokens, and we pre-processed it. So I will show you in a few minutes a simple example how this will look like. And then there are some, definitions or some things that how we will call it and how is it typically called in the area of text analysis. This is what I also want to share with you in the beginning. So we have a set of the documents. This is usually called the corpus. And within this whole set of documents, we have a certain set or a certain collection of words. So if we we'll only take a look at the unique words, okay, meaning now we are not looking at the tokens. So today I'm going to the, and we're going to the, so we have two times, but only if we take into account the word to like once, then this is called the term. And the term and the lists of term, so the unique words that we have in the overall corpus, is then what will be called the lexicon. Okay, I think this is way more intuitive, so because this is like how we're learning languages in general. Okay, if we want to learn a foreign language, then we have a lexicon, and obviously in the lexicon every word only occurs for one time and we learn about what it means. And so when we have our corpus, which is the collection of the documents, then we have a lexicon, which consists of terms. So the terms are the unique word identifiers. But each document obviously may have the same word for multiple times, and that is when we call it a token. Okay, so bringing it into some form of numerical shape, what we have two dimensions typically. Typically, we have a certain number of documents. We will, denote this with N. So we have N documents, and we will have a lexicon consisting of D unique tokens, which are the terms, okay? So if we, for instance, wanna build what is called a bag of words representation of our document term matrix, so now we're bringing text into the world of math because we will use a matrix. And a matrix is something that you know has columns and has rows, okay? And the dimension of the matrix is then usually given by the amount of rows times the amount of columns. And now, for instance, if we have a document term matrix, our first dimension is always the document. So this is the number of the rows. And our second dimension is the specific word. And each column will represent a single word, so a single term in our corpus. Then we have an N times D document term matrix. Some books also use term document matrix. That's just the transposed form of the document term matrix, and kind of depends how you want to present the methods. So I'm preferring here the document term matrix, okay? Now, if you want to take a look at our first simple model, how can we transform the information of a document into numerical way? What we can use is the so-called bag of words representation, okay? Because if we have a document term matrix, then in each row we have the document. And let's assume, I don't know, our first word that exists in our lexicon is the word apple. Then for the first document, we count the number of times the word apple is used in the first document. And if it happens like 5 times, then in our matrix, in the first row at the first column, we will enter a value of 5, okay? Now if, for instance, the second word is apply, then we take a look how many times does apply occur in the first document. It's 3 times. Then our entry in this matrix in the first row still, but in the second column referring to the word apply, will be a value of 3. So for each row, for each document, we will have a vector that has the size or the dimension of the number of unique words in the lexicon, so in the overall corpus. And so what we basically do is we're calculating the frequencies, how many times each unique word occurs in a certain document. And this is our first way, called the bag of words approach, how we can transform a textual information into a numerical representation of it. Okay. Obviously, if you're only calculating the frequency of the words, there is no distinguishing regarding the semantic meaning or the how the words are represented as sequences of the text, which also can be very meaningful. Okay, so it can be very meaningful if a word occurs in the beginning in the sentence or in the end of a sentence. This is some kind of information that is not retained in the bag of words approach. Here we only have like the counting how many words do occur in a certain document, but obviously that can be helpful information as well, because I don't know, if we have a document that talks a lot of technical innovation and about apples, for instance, then probably we have a document that talks about the development of Apple products or something like this, okay? So this is our first way. And then we go to the second way now, and after that we'll go take a look at a small example. So a second way can be what is called a term frequency inverse document frequency representation. And this sounds more complex than it is, because, you know, some words may occur many times in many documents, even though they are not stop words. So for instance, if we have a corpus of financial news, the word bear or bull market, for instance, may occur in many of those documents. So, and if we always have those words occurring in those documents, they are not really informative, again, with respect to distinguish between those documents, or to, you know, get the information what really we're talking about in these documents, if those words always occurring in these documents. So what we can do is we can check out if we have a word and if it may only occurs in a few documents, because if it only occurs in a few documents, then it might be more like a special word which may help us to identify the few documents and also the maybe specially shared content that is only present in those few documents, okay? To do so, we weight each occurrence of the word, okay? So if we have our first dimension I and J is the second, so the first is the row and the second is the column and the first is again the document and the second is the word, then originally, we have this representation that we can write in vector form for each document, which is the vector, and at each element, we have the amount of total frequency of the word in the document. Now we can weight each of those words with a weighting that depends on if the word is often used in all documents or if it's only used in a few documents. And to get this weighting, we calculate it like this. So n is the overall number of documents, and for the jth word, nj is how many times does this specific word j occur in, or in how many documents does it occur? Okay, so take a look. It's called the inverse document because a frequency or relative frequency would be the reciprocal of this term inside the brackets here. Meaning, you know, if it occurs in 10 out of 100 documents, that would be like the reciprocal of this. Of this number here, but here if we have a, as it's stated here, the smaller this one is, the more often the terms appear in the different documents, okay? Because this is, assume that a specific word J only occurs in one document, then we have a large number and divided by one, okay? So a really big number. And the more this word occurs in all documents, the smaller this will get, and also the smaller the log of it will get. Okay, so this is small if it appears often, and this is high if it's appearing only in a few documents. And now, if we weight each of the actual frequencies with this one, here we have higher values if a word occurs often and if it only occurs in a few documents, but very often, okay? Because this can be more informative, can be more helpful to distinguish really some special words, which will help us to really, you know, differentiate among the documents. And obviously this, again, like this is calculated more or less in the same way. So this ends up in a n times d matrix, but now instead of the absolute frequencies at each position in the matrix, we have the weighted frequencies, and they are weighted with the inverse document frequency. That's why it's called the term frequency inverse document frequency, even though it's a very long, a long ordering of different words. I think it's more easy than we think. Okay, so let's see how this works in action with a very simplified example. I am starting a collab here. It's gets the name, I think it will be number 5, and we will see text analysis. So if we have in the beginning a very small corpus, okay, assume each sentence representing a single document. So we have a collection of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 documents. And here you can see we have a big capital letters, we have a number here, and we have still punctuation. So in the beginning, what I usually would do is to pre-process the text. I wrote here a rather simple pre-processing function by myself, but also in the different packages that are available for you know, textual analysis in Python, they also come along with certain pre-processing functions. And you can take a look for yourself, depending on the package you're using, if such a function is given and if it's helpful. And if it's helpful, can be decided by usually taking a look at the outcome. So at least for some random collection, we can take a look if everything looks fine in the first way. Okay. After that, when we have a really big collection, then we need to do this a little bit more professional way. But for the moment, you can see after applying, for instance, this pre-processing function to each of the sentences above, we can see what happens. We have no punctuation, we have no numbers, and we have only a small capital letters here. Okay, so that is would be our first step. And for some methods also, this is handled internally. So for instance, if you want to take a look at the back of Word representation, then the sklearn package provides here the count vectorizer function. I mean, this is by far not the only way or method to generate back of Word representations, but let's first take a look at it, because I think sklearn is widely spread package, and we already also worked with it. And so let's take a look at it first. So if we, you know, as we are used to it when we're working with the sklearn package, first we define an instance of the count vectorizer class, and then use the fit transform method. What happens internally is some pre-processing, some collecting or some building of a lexicon with the unique terms in our corpus, and then the counting of the words per document, and then we can have their representation here. Originally, when we just use the transform method, what we will get is a so-called sparse representation of the metrics or of the rows here. Sparse representation means typically, especially if we have many numbers in a corpus, for a document we will have many zero entries, okay? Because there will be many words that are not used in a specific document. And if we have a matrix or a row with many zeros, then often a sparse representation, so that means a reduced representation of the original data, is helpful in order to save some memory space on your computer. So a sparse representation simply remembers the non-zero entries, because if it's supposed to work something or to do something with that later, it knows all the remaining entries are zero, and it can rebuild the original version of it shortly before it does something with it. Okay, but here to visualize it, I am using the toArray method, so it brings the sparse representation to a representation like we would be used to from a typical array, so a matrix representation, and I use it the pandas. The pandas package here in order to really give you a good representation of the bag of words that we have here. Okay, so for instance, our first sentence is machine learning is so interesting, so that's why after M and so on are zero entries, but we have a machine and learning here once. And you can see in the original form we had machine learning, so obviously that's important, because learning machine is something completely different or doesn't even make sense here, but this meaning gets lost when we are using the back of words representation. Okay, so we have that one here, and as you can see here, even with our five sentences, we have already a lot of words here, so a big lexicon comparably, and so each row is given, it was defined by a large amount of single numbers here, so had as a large dimensionality, and this can be reduced by, for instance, eliminating the stop words. Stop words are, as I said, words that occur many different times. Again, there are different definitions of stop words list. Here I'm using the one provided by a package called gensim, and I defined above here and downloaded here. Okay, we can take a look at that by ourselves, but usually it's like the common English words that we experience, like to or the or something like this. Okay, and you can see here, for instance, M and R, they are all stop words. After is a stop word, so those words do not reoccur in our back of words representation after we remove the stop words. Okay, and this can be done by simply giving here a list of stop words. And this reduces the dimension, and a lower representation, meaning a lower dimension representation, is always kind of helpful, especially if we reconsider the curse of dimensionality and if you want to calculate something with those vectors later. Okay, last but not least, very similar to the count vectorizer, we can use the tf-idf vectorizer, and instead of the absolute frequencies, we get the inverse term document frequencies, and but it's more or less done in the same way when we you're doing with the sklearn package. Okay, so this is should give you hopefully a first information how we can transform textual information into numerical information, and obviously the aim would be now to do something with those rows here, you know, use those rows and the input of those rows for our whatever quantitative methods we want to use in order to further extract information about textual information here. Okay, many things could be you know, said here, like the usage of what is called an n-gram. So for instance, machine learning is typically better considered to be a single term because it is a single term, or like McDonald's or stuff like that. So we could further, you know, let, for instance, the count vectorizer or also the tf-idf vectorizer find such bigrams. Bigrams is something if we consider two words that belong together. But yeah, as always, I try not to overshoot here. So just that you know, sometimes it makes sense to also search for bi or trigrams. And those are, you know, words that reoccur together more than once, typically, at least in a whole corpus. So, but I think you get the idea here, okay? So, and it could be easily done by simply stating in the count vectorizer definition here the usage of n-gram words. But yeah, maybe we'll like take a look at this at a later point in time. For the moment, I hope you get the feeling how text can be transformed into numbers. And also those matrices that we can see here may serve as a starting point for further methods that belong to the textual analysis. But we will take a look at this in the next video. So for the moment, take care and see you in the next video. Bye bye.